Good morning. Myself, Kritika, Assistant Professor in the Department of Civil Engineering, Baikar, going to handle you the subject Construction Technology. And the subject code will be U18PCCE302. So the next slide will be showing the content of this presentation. So I'm going to cover about the introduction of construction, specification. In specification, its types, importance, purpose, and at last we'll see about the construction coordination. So what is construction? Construction is one of the branches of civil engineering. So buildings are not being raised right now. It's been from long ago in history, but the difference is of only technology, as early buildings will be very simple and it is just for the purpose of shelter. Whereas right now, the technology is also playing a huge impact on the construction. So in the beginning, buildings were made from stones and mud. But in recent time, we are constructing the building using multiple types of materials, including stone, timber, concrete, metals, glass, and etc. Now the evolution of the material has been happened from the monolithic construction to masonry. Masonry from we have been shifted to PCC, RCC, glass, and now it is in the composite types. So construction is a process that consists of a building or assembling the infrastructure. So that is the construction, right? So far from being a single activity, large scale construction is a feat of multitasking. As it is a multitasking, so the proper planning and designing should be there. So generally the in the construction site, it will be managed by the project manager. And again, it will be supervised by the construction manager, design engineer, construction engineer, or project architect. So what we need for the successful execution of a project, we need the proper planning. The planning should be very effective. So those involved with the design and execution of the infrastructure in question must consider the environment and impact of the job, successful scheduling, budgeting, site safety, availability of material, logistics, inconvenience to the public caused by construction delays, preparing tender documents. All these things which I have discussed should be taken care of by the project manager. So I'm saying one more time, what are the things? It should be scheduling should be proper, the budgeting should be to the point, the site safety, that is the most primary thing which we have to control, as it's including involving the human safety. So availability of materials, logistics, and inconvenience to the public caused by construction delays and preparing tender documents. So all these things should be taken care while we are planning. So that it's about the construction technology. Construction industry includes a wide range of construction that is suitable for all class of society, from lower class to the upper middle class. So there are certain types of construction methods. So we know commercial construction, domestic construction, that is all our residential thing will come under domestic construction. Industrial construction, that is as the word described, it is for the industries. Heavy or civil construction, you can say it is a bridges, dams. These are the few examples that are now displayed in the masterpieces of construction technologies. So this is this about specification. So we have seen about the construction and its evolvement in the recent era. Now we are moving to the introduction to specification. What is specification, guys? Specification is nothing but a proper description or detailed description of the quality of materials and workmanship required to complete the engineering project. So according with its drawing and details is known as specification. So it is a proper definition I have given here. So a detailed description of the quality of materials and workmanship required to complete an engineering project, its occurrence with its drawing and detail is known as specification. So a specification is nothing but along with the drawing, so we will give the scheduling etc. form the part of the contract document that translate the client's requirement into the eventual building or construction. So this point is describing nothing but, so specification we will be giving along with the part of the contract document. So we are fulfilling the client's requirement into the eventual building or construction. So in the construction industry, owners, architects, and designers must be specific about the project necessary work for completion. If anything which differs from the specification and the contract, it will be cause some chaos between the architects and designers. So it should be proper and to the point. Specification in construction describe the materials, labor, and skill required for construction development. So if contractors are not able to communicate these specifications, what will happen? The delay in the construction process will be occurring. So there is a formal process dedicated to the building specification because it plays a huge role in the construction. So there is a process, formal process, which will be following in the construction for the building specification. So these are the specification details which will be followed in the specification process. The type of the material and quality of the material will be shown. The method of preparation of an item, that BOQs, that is bill of quantities, will be followed. Quality of workmanship, methods of measurement of an item, and other details related to the item. So these are the specifications, these are the details in the specification will be shown. So the specification show the following, we have already discussed. The specifications are generally classified into two types, general specification, detailed specification. Okay, as the word described, general specification, what is that? The specification will be shown generally in the drawings itself. So the space in the drawing, we can show the certain general specification. Whereas in detailed specification, we have to discuss everything about. So the separate document has to be prepared for the detailed specification along with the contract document. What are the materials, types, how we are going to prepare, and about the workmanship, about the scheduling, budgeting, and other details, everything related to the project will be shown in the detailed specification. So here are the few points I have listed about the general specification. In general specification, we will be showing only about the nature and class of works in the name of material and proportion. So that should be used in the various item of works will be described. That is on the only brief specification only will be given, not in detail. So that is the point. Only a brief description of each and every item is given, and it is useful for estimating the project roughly. So without going through the lengthy detailed specification, general information for the quantities of material, nature, and class of work can be known from the general specification. But the main thing is general specification is not the part of the contract document, whereas the detailed specification will be the form of contract document. So now it is all about detailed specification. So detailed specification form a part of the contract document. So detailed specification for a particular item specify the quality, quantities, and proportion of material and the method of preparation, execution for that particular item work in a project. So in detailed specification, we can consider if you are going for a foundation alone, how much quantity of materials or what are the equipments we are going to use, what about the labors we are going to follow, like how many labors we are going to allow. So material description, labor description, equipment description, the budgeting, scheduling, the time duration, everything in detail we will be discussing on the detailed specification. So that is one of the example. So the detailed specification of the different items of works are prepared separately, and they describe what the work should be and how they shall be executed and constructed. Physical, chemical, and electrical tests, if any, required for the finished work to ensure the desired strength or quality are specified in the detailed specification. So if after the construction, if it is going for any physical, chemical, or electrical tests, so the material which we have specified should be on desired strength and quality, then it can pass all those tests. So the material strength should be a proper thing which we have to consider in the specification itself. So the last point will be the machinery, equipments, and special tools or plants. The method of operation when involved during execution are described in the detailed specification. This point has been discussed early itself. So the method and duration of protection of finished work are required specified in the detailed specification, and this also specified the involvement and responsibility for auxiliary works, incidental damage, etc. So during execution of the original work, while writing the detailed specification, the same order of sequence as the work is to be carried out and it is maintained. So it is nothing but, so in the execution of construction project, we will be starting from the site clearance to the final closing phase, right? So in the same order, the specification, detailed specification, should be written so that it can be checked and maintained easily. So engineering department maintain detailed specification for different item of work, and those things will be carried out work. So we have seen about the specification at early slide. Now why we are going to see why the specification is most important. Okay, sometimes it is not possible to furnish the information on the drawing, that is for general specification which we discussed regarding the quality of materials to be used and the quality of workmanship to be achieved during construction due to shortage of space. So specification provides such a usual data in a separate document. As we already discussed, in the drawing itself we cannot describe the quality of a material in very much of detail and depth. So for that we are maintaining the separate document so that which can be verified easily and which can be very much clear in the documentation purposes. So drawings and specification form two important contract document. So in case of discrepancy between the drawings, the specification provision of the specification are given more legal strength and shall govern. Okay, so the rates of item depends on the specification. The items rate will also be mentioned there. So if the specifications are rigid and depends for superior quality, the rate of item will increase and it will again be the vice versa. So during the supervising the work, the project manager should carry the specification always so that he can verify it easily on site itself. So the specification of items are required by the contractor to fill the rate of item in the tender document. So in the tender document, the contractor will just fill the specification of the item. So the specification will play a huge role. So these are the purpose of specification. So I have given in the simple points. So a purpose is main to describe the quality of different material required for the construction work, and it enables the department, engineers, architects and contractor to procure and check the material quality as per specification. So once the specification is missed, these department people, engineers, architect, contractor, project manager, everyone can check while they are procuring the material and its quality and its strength. So to specify the quality of workmanship and method of doing the same, specifications are required to clarify the drawings. Specifications are helpful to the contractor in filling the rates of various items in the tender. Excuse me. So specification of a work serves as a guide to the supervising staff of the owner as well as contractor to execute the work to their satisfaction. Specifications are necessary to verify and check the strength of material for a work. So specification is essential contract document and it is required for arbitration. Arbitration is nothing but the dispute between the contractor and owner. If anything arises, so there will be the third party will involve and they'll solve the dispute between the contractor and owner. During that time, the specification document will play a huge role. And court cases also. So specification is necessary to specify the equipments, tools and plans to be engaged for a work and thus enable to procure them beforehand. So we have seen the specification up to now. So now we are entering into the sequence of activities. What sequence of activities? Nothing but where the construction process start and how it will end. So there will be a five major process. It's nothing but the start project, that is initiation, interface or start project. Next, it will lead to the initiating processes. After that, the planning and executing processes will come, that is monitoring and controlling processes. That will be followed by the closing processes. After that, it will be exit phase and end project. Okay, so these will be the sequence of activities: interface or start project, initiating process, next planning process, executing process, next closing phase and exit phase. So it will be called as initiating, planning, executing, monitoring and control and closing. Now that we have identified the schedule activities, we need to sequence them in a logical order and find out whether dependents exist among the activities. That is nothing but we have to schedule everything in the logical order. If any activity needs the help of the other activity, we have to check that dependence, anything is happening in the activities. So interactivity of logical relationship must be sequenced correctly in order to facilitate the development of the achievable project. Okay, so we will consider the classic example. Let's say if we are going to build a house that might be a ground plus two floor, what are the things we have to follow, how the sequence of the activities will be followed. Okay, so you must, we all know that before that we have to do the site clearance, after that excavation should be carried write out for the foundation work. So we'll see. I'll just shown up, put up the certain images for your better understanding. Okay. So these are the general order of the construction work. Order of construction: excavation, timbering, foundation, concrete floors, reinforced concrete frame, roof, brickwork, internal fixtures and fittings, insulation work, plumbing and wiring, painting and decorating. So this is the example for sequence of activities. First we'll go with the footing. After footing, the column will be erected. After column, we will backfill the soil for the smooth level surface. After that, we'll construct the each floors. So this is the typical example for a G+2 structure. Okay, so this images will explain you the detailed thing how the G+2 construction will be carried out. Okay, so the first thing, we'll do the layout marking. So that is for placing the column that will be used. So after marking the layout, we have to excavate for footings. The footing has to be excavated. So anti-termite treatment should be done in the substructure level till plinth level. So it is the most important and it is the most dangerous thing. So the proper precaution should be taken while we are doing the anti-termite treatment. So excavation of footings, you can see in this image. After excavation, we will be going for PCC for footing. PCC is nothing but plain cement concrete. After PCC, we'll have a marking for footing. So this is the reinforcement. The steel rods are placed for the reinforcement. After reinforcement, the shuttering will be taken place. So after shuttering, we have to do concrete for footing. After concrete of footing, we need certain time for curing. After that, we'll provide starters for column. Starters for column is nothing but to build the column, we need to put a starter, that is a base band. We have to put it. That is next will be column box shuttering. Column box shuttering, after column box shuttering, we will pour the concrete and the formwork shuttering will be removed. Okay, after that, backfilling and compaction. You can see the column have been raised from the substructure in that backfilling and compaction image. After that, anti-termite treatment, everything has to be done early stage itself. After that, we'll be going for PCC for plinth beam, that is plain cement concrete for plinth beam. So next, plinth beam shuttering is taking place and the column curing also taking place for the 14 days. Okay. So hacking for column will be taken place. Next, why hacking for columns? So with that only we can place any material above the column. It will be easy for the purposes. So next will be grade slab casting. Grade slab casting is nothing but you can see the person what he is doing. So he is doing the grade slab casting work. Next will be the brickwork. Brickwork. After brickwork, electrical work and electrical conduits work will be carried out. Bull marks for plastering. Bull marks has been placed for the purpose for plastering. For smooth plastering, we have to keep the bull marks and the even surface. To create an even surface in the plastering, we have to keep the bull marks. The next one will be external plastering. So external plastering is nothing but the outer wall, outer surface of the building. That is the external plastering. Window fixturing of windows. So we have to do some drill works to fix the windows. Next, the marble, the flooring work. The flooring can be the marble, tile, granite, for anything for the residential building. Plumbing work, wall tiling. Wall tiling generally happen in the kitchen. So floor tiling, skirting has been provided. False ceiling. After end of the construction, we'll go for false ceiling and the installation of our plumbing fixtures. Final, the two coats putty, one coat primer and two coat paint will be given on the walls. Okay, so you can see electrical fixtures. So entire construction process, once it's done, we will go for the architectural purpose, aesthetic look purposes, garden works, everything will be carried out. So these are the general construction process which will be carried out in the G+2 building. Here we are seeing about the construction coordination. We have already seen, right? Initiation, planning, execution, monitoring, tracking, and closure. These are the five basic project processes and flow and deliverables. Okay. In installation, we'll see about contracts and initiation process. We'll see about contracts and scope. Contract and scope is nothing but we have to define the project regarding to scope, Team identification, we have to identify the team. Team identification in the sense, the planning team, designing team, project managers team, we have to identify all those team. Types of job deliverable, we have to describe the types of job deliverable. Preliminary estimate and tentative schedule will be prepared in the initiation stage. Whereas in planning, we have to see design, contract and scope, as well as design and drawings. So project requisition of document, drawing standards, we have to check with IS codes, presentation of all those standards, drawing the templates, assumption, logs, etc. will be carried on design and drawing. Whereas while in execution phase, tenders, status to statutory approvals, whereas construction or resource deployment will be happened in the execution phase. Okay, so these all will be quality control, bills and payments, everything will be happening in the execution phase itself. So that comes under scheme distribution, task definition. WBS is nothing but work-based structure, cash flow estimations, detailed drawings. Any issue response tree will be checked. Quality assurance and quality control documents. So these all will be taken care. Quality control check, drawing or reviews and archives, resource management, clash and coordination, and actual updates will be done in the execution phase. Okay. So whereas the final will be closure. In the closure, we'll check QC, that is quality control and quality assurance also, and de-snagging or commissioning, or we'll see about what are the lessons that we have learned from this construction also. So that is de-snagging deliverables, add-ons, overall efficiency report, support transition, archival and closer, and handover process will be taken place in the closer. So the this image explained with clearly about the project process flow and deliverables. So construction coordination, client has to work with both public sector and the private sector. Whereas public sector, how the flowchart will be, authorities, federal or state or local authorities will be there, supplier will be there, nominated supplier, manufacturer, vendor, distributor, and again it will come with manpower, administration, site management, a site worker. After the supplier, it will goes to financial. The financial is nothing but bank, finance company, credit corporation or leasing company. Whereas in client, consultant, it will comes to project management consultant, planner or architect, engineer, quantity surveyor, land surveyor, interior designer or landscape architect. After that, main contractor. So they all will design and come to the conclusion of the plan, and it will be handed over to the main contractor for the execution of the project. So contractor. So domestic subcontractor, nominated subcontractor. So this is the flowchart which explains the how the public and private sector will arise. Okay. So coordination can be seen as process of managing resources in an organized manner so that a higher degree of operational efficiency can be achieved for a given project. So without a coordination, proper execution of project in the site will not happen. So the coordination should be the important factor. Okay, coordination is nothing but what? It is of managing resources in an organized manner. Okay, so there will be two coordination methods have been identified. One will be direct contact and another is meeting, through meetings. Okay, what here we'll see indirect contact. What is direct contact? It is the simplest form, involves minimal cost among the method of coordination. Okay, there will be two types of direct contact. It's a formal contact and informal contact. So a combination of these methods could send reasonably accurate messages quickly in all directions and could be able to deal with all major uncertainties that arise within the project organization. So combination of either formal or informal contact give you the solution for the messages that arise in the constructions, okay, or solution for the uncertainties which arise in the project organization. So this is all about direct formal contact. So direct formal contact refers to the documented information sent through, that could be obtained by letters, memos and reports. That is a direct formal contact. So this approach will be more formal and it is widely used as a means of communication among different organizations that are involved in a project. Like example, architect, project manager, contractor. So everyone will be dealing in the construction process, right? So the communication between these departments will be done with a formal contact through memos, letters and reports. So direct formal contact has been identified as one of the means used by designers for obtaining the design information. So that is one of the way where design information can be used by designers for the direct formal contact method. In managing a risky project, proper documents are always needed to protect the participants involved. So these contact memos or letters should be filed for the future references. This is all about informal contact. Any information obtained using informal conversation, that is through telephone call or discussions, is categorized under direct informal contact. Whereas in formal contact, it will be dealt with any letters or memos. Here, it can be either telephonic conversation or any discussions which happens informally. So one of the advantages of using direct informal contact is like the information can be gathered quickly without the need of any formal procedure. So informal contact will give you the quick solution and clear information in a short time, and it is useful in confirming certain issues pertaining to the design process. So therefore, the direct informal contact could resolve the problem of inefficiency in flow of design information, especially when design changes occur during the construction stage. So informal contact will resolve the problem of inefficiency. If any inefficiency happened in the flow of design information, the direct informal contact will lead to the design changes that's happening in the construction stage. So one of the advantages of using direct informal contact is all about information can be gathered quickly without the need of any formal procedures. So it provides a clear information short time. So this is all happening in the direct informal contact. Okay. So we have seen about the direct contact. In direct contact, it's about formal contact and informal contact. So formal contact is all about procuring, getting letters or memos or discussing with those things. Informal contact can be happened through telephonic conversation. So the information will be very clear and very quick. So any design changes happening, it can be sorted out very easily. So now we are heading into the meeting. The purpose of the meeting is to keep key participants informed and handle shared problems arising in the project. So meetings are one way to increase the amount of information in construction project, as meeting mostly covers the current issue of the design. So meeting is it's one way to increase the amount of information in construction project. So all the feedbacks and comments from the design team participant could be discussed instantly in the meeting. So in the meeting, we can discuss elaborately about all the issues happening in the construction industry currently. So there are two types of meetings. One is scheduled, one is unscheduled. The scheduled meeting for the design process are conducted at interval of 1 week to report of the progress of the design work. So scheduled meeting, the engineers, the project manager will schedule the meeting with the architects or client or any structural engineer to discuss about the progress of the work which is happening on the construction site. During the proper scheduled meeting, they can discuss about any changes or any variation in the design and the execution phase. Everything will be discussed and sorted out at the scheduled meeting. Whereas in unscheduled meeting, it would be held if there was any urgent emergency occurring in the site and to solve current issues related to design. This type of meeting will normally take over from the scheduled meeting if the design process when work has started on site or between the intervals of scheduled meeting. So scheduled meeting will happen between the intervals of the unscheduled meeting will happen interval between the scheduled meeting if any emergency occurs in the construction process, any variations in design or anything happens with the construction field, the unscheduled meeting will be happening. So the problems arising on site, such as differences in drawings that need to be solved urgently, or typical situations when an unscheduled meeting would be called. So we have come to the last slide of the presentation. So certain things we have to keep as a project manager while we are working on the site. So the quality of the work we have to maintain. Once we have started the work quality should be checked at proper prior interval so that everything is going on planned way. So, and the problems should be picked up quickly so that there won't be any delay in construction at the later stage. So as per schedule, everything should go on order. So for example, if wall framing is going in the wrong direction, it needs to be sorted before the wall is going up. So that will be the one example. If any construction is happening, we have to sort it out quickly so that there won't be any delay in the construction process. As a builder or project manager, we have to ensure that materials are checked off in the regular manner and when they arrive also. The important thing is when the material is arriving on site, it has to be checked whether what all we ordered and the, whether the materials are in, with the proper requirement. So we have to check that. And timber should be of specified treatment type and at specified moisture level. So then the house is set out correctly on the site. Plans and specifications are followed. That is the most important thing. So we should not deviate on plans and specifications. So materials are installed to manufacturer's instruction so that if we are following the manufacturer's instruction, in future any error is coming on the site, we can easily claim. So so the material should be installed with manufacturer's instruction only. So finished construction is protected from the weather. So that is the most important things that we should keep on mind while we are working as a project manager on the site. So the overall summary of this presentation, we have started with the construction. We have discussed about the construction, how the technologies emerged from the olden era to the current generation. Next, we have talked about the specifications, purpose of specification, and what is the importance of specification and specification types. We have detailed that specification and general specification we have listed out. After that, we have studied about the construction coordination, initiation, planning, execution, monitoring, and closure. We have studied about all this. After that, we have come to the that meeting, scheduled meeting, unscheduled meeting, formal contact, informal contact. So we have studied about all these things in the construction coordinated parts. Hope this video is helpful for you guys. Thank you.